Do you have like a checklist of, okay, these are the top things that we look for when we identify and choose a partner?
We have a very important filter with which we understand if the company is good for us. Let me tell you, they need to be at least 8 years on the market, so like 2 cycles of real estate. They need to have a reasonable size, so deliver, let me say, at least 2,000 homes every year, more or less. They need to have a super, super clean approach to business without any clouds. You know, we do our background checks and we meet the people. When everything ticks off, we are ready to establish the partnership. And this is working very well in Colombia, in Brazil, in India. And this is the way to go.
All right, folks, welcome back to another episode of the Monk Realty Show. Today, we have a good friend of ours, Mr. Daniele Russolillo, joining us from the Planet Group. He is currently the Chief Operating Officer as well as the Deputy CEO to Planet Holdings UK. Danny, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Fantastic. So just for context, for those of you tuning in today, Danny and I, we first met, I think, in 2018, 2019, when Planet was just getting started in India. We visited a few sites and we explored a few projects. And from there to now, they've come a very long way, both in India as well as in their global aspirations. So congrats on all the progress, especially in such short time.
Absolutely. And I remember perfectly when we met. It was at the very beginning of Planet. I barely knew what Pune was. I had an idea where Bangalore was, but not Pune. Never been there before. Right. And now I'm sitting actually in a hotel in Pune because I'm spending some days here for work. And it was amazing. Right. It's been a great ride.
Fantastic. So let's maybe like jump right in, right? For myself, like I've been looking at Planet Group quite closely for a few years now. But from your perspective, or for someone who's kind of getting introduced to Planet Group completely new right now, how would you maybe introduce the company?
It's very simple. The vision of the company, which is based in London, with the headquarters in London and present in various countries, we'll hit on that later, is to raise the standards of affordable housing in countries characterized by high level of housing deficit. So India, Brazil, you name it. We can go through the target countries or planet whenever you want. The point is that we want to do it with a twist. We are not a traditional real estate developer. We have 2 layers of innovation. One more, let's say, prop tech slash digital. The second more related to social innovation, which makes us really different from other developers. And on top of that, let me also tell you that we do it differently because we have a global approach. And this has directly to do with the way we provide R&D services for all the companies of the group.
Very interesting. Let's maybe start with the global focus itself. Most developers hesitate even to leave one city that they've kind of focused and built operations in. And I know so many developers in Bangalore who don't even leave a certain zip code, right? So they really want to build hyper-local expertise. And it takes them many years, possibly decades, to even leave the city and go to the next city, leave alone, you know, think about multi-country operations. But Planet, right from the day you started more as a global company, right? With operations in India, Brazil, and a couple more in the pipeline. So what led to that thought? And how do you kind of manage operations when you're doing, you know, multiple countries, that too, for a company that's so early in its own life cycle?
So let me tell you, everything started with the idea that real estate is a super local business, like you correctly say. How can you do things differently? We needed a global approach for basically 3 reasons. The first one, remember Planet was born in Brazil, in South America, from the 2 founders, Gianni Savio, currently the global CEO, and Susana Marchioni, currently the CEO of the Brazilian operations. And they started from Brazil. But they understood that what they were doing in Brazil to raise the standards of affordable housing could become a global concept. Why? Because we work in a very, very specific segment. We only do affordable residential housing.
There's no other segment. There's no commercial. There's no hospitality. So let me tell you, since the very beginning, Planet understood that the key for growth was to have a scalable and replicable format. Understanding that the need of the households, doesn't matter if it's in Brazil or India, let's say 85-90% are exactly the same. Families want a safe place to raise their kids. They want to try to save some money when they run the house with the operational expenses, and they want to live in a beautiful place because, you know, it's important to, when you wake up in the morning, to know that you're actually staying in a beautiful home and a beautiful neighborhood with people you can trust. This, trust me, is the same all over the world. Why is it important to have a format? Because volumes and scaling up is a lot easier. Then, if you have a global approach with a global format, you can actually do what you said it was difficult for a real estate developer, like going in other countries, a lot more easily. But then why we want to go in different countries? Well, let me tell you, if you take 6-7 countries in the world, let's say India, Vietnam, Indonesia, Brazil, Mexico, and Colombia, you basically have 40% of the global affordable housing demand in the world. Only 7 countries. So in this way, you can have a huge market. I'll tell you some numbers later. And at the same time, with a global approach, you're pretty confident that, of course, there are currency risks, of course, there are operational risks, because emerging countries sometimes are a little bit less stable than mature economies. But if you go into all of them at the same time, maybe India is accelerating when Brazil is slowing down and vice versa. So you manage your risks in a very interesting way. So at run rate, when you have projects in all these countries at the same time, even if one goes not as you really thought, all the others will catch up. And this is a new concept for real estate, because real estaters are super local guys, and they need to be. I understand, they need to be. But, you know, the third reason then is that we wanted to be able to invest in research and development. And only if a company has, a business where you can produce very interesting returns, like affordable housing can give you in some countries, and you invest what you get, you can develop all those replicable formats, that technology, those innovation. Sometimes a developer works at the local level, doesn't do. Instead, for us, R&D was very, very, very important. We don't, we don't cash all the money we make. We invest. We invest in R&D. In Turin, in Italy, in this moment, we have a competence center, which is focused on ESG and PropTech. So we're talking about real estate, PropTech and ESG, with more than 300 people.
Wow.
And this serves the innovation needs of all the group. So when we talk about PropTech or the Planet platform, digital platform, or we talk the Planet framework for community development in our communities, our competence center is the place all these innovations are created in.
Very interesting. I think two very good takeaways for me from this are, one, by launching more globally, essentially it's a hedge, right? Like, so one can do well, one might not do well, but you effectively try to come out ahead. So that makes that super interesting. Also, your strategy on innovation and centralizing quite a lot of your operations, right? Like into Turin, especially on the innovation and design side, makes really interesting sense. Let me ask you a question here, right? Something that we notice is that the design requirements of many different parts of the world are different. Like, for example, I notice quite a bit whenever I go to, let's say, Southeast Asia, that kitchens are not as important in Southeast Asia. I say that because there's a big takeout food culture, right? I've seen so many houses which don't even have a kitchen, and even when they do, it's really more of a small kitchenette. Versus, let's say, in India, where kitchen is so important, and, you know, like a home cooked food is so important, and that's just like one important design change. Are there other design challenges like this that you stumble across where different regions in the world have like completely different design requirements?
This is a very important question because first of all, I'm Italian, so I like to speak about food and kitchens. This is very, very important. The second point is that, you know, what you mentioned is where sometimes companies fail when they go abroad in countries and they don't respect enough the local requirements. Our recipe is very simple. Go with a local development partner. Usually we create relationships where we bring equity, technology, social innovation framework, design as well, but we have the majority of the voting rights in the local SPV. So basically we control the situation, but we find the local partner who wants to co-invest with us. Talking about the special purpose vehicle at the local level, that we run the development project, we usually, you know, 10, 20, 30% goes to the local developer. Why? Because he needs to have skin in the game and needs to help us to exactly not make any mistakes like the one you were saying, in case I go to Southeast Asia and I produce an 800 feet kitchen that nobody is going to use. You know, the local development partner is important to understand local culture, land titles, permits, authorization procedures, and of course the markets itself, because being a developer itself, he will have run all his sales, you know? And of course, we need a partner like that to run the sales at the local level. We don't go alone. Going alone is arrogant and sometimes prone to failure.
Interesting. And how do you go about sourcing a local partner? Because there are so many real estate developers and construction companies, all of whom could be partners for you, right? So do you have like a checklist of, okay, these are the top things that we look for when we identify and choose a partner?
So you will remember very well, when we met, we were exactly in the phase of looking for our partner. In this moment, in India, we partnered with a great developer in the city of Pune, Kulti Patil Developers Limited. Company has been on the market for many, many years, very refined. Why we end up partnering with Sir Rajesh Patil? Because we met many, many. I calculated probably something like 80 operators, 80, between developers, large developers, smallest developer, medium developer, landowners, brokers. We met a lot of people. And traditional way, so we didn't go through the usual government, chamber of commerce, and you know, embassy. No, we took our plane. We had the luck to know some very competent in real estate people in India, and of course, you know, some of them are mutual friends. And we started because we need to understand bottom up, and of course, we have a grid. We have a very important filter with which we understand if the company is good for us. Let me tell you, they need to be at least 8 years on the market, so like two cycles of real estate. They need to have a reasonable size, so deliver, let me say, at least 2,000 homes every year, more or less. They need to have a super, super clean approach to business, without any clouds. You know, we do our background checks and we meet the people. When everything ticks off, we are ready to establish the partnership. And this is working very well in Colombia, in Brazil, in India, and this is the way to go.
Interesting. So much of the focus for Planet is around affordable housing. I'm just thinking, do you also have a focus on rental housing as well? Because especially in the affordable segment, rental becomes like a very, very key driver of the affordable segment itself. So is that part of the focus? Is that not something that you're looking at for the time being? What's the strategy there?
So let me tell you, nothing is ever written in stone if you want to create a business that follows the trends of the time. We, 99% of our business model is focused on build to sell, because in emerging economy, especially in an aspirational approach to life, people want to start to climb the social ladder. Sometimes they are the first owners in the wrong family tradition buying the assets. This is what happened. And it was the same in Europe in the 60s, and it is what happens. But countries like India, Brazil, these countries are moving fast. So rental is happening, especially in very high densely populated cities where, for instance, the cost of the price of land is very high. It makes sense also to have a build-to-rent offer. In this moment, we're only one project with build-to-rent, which is a typical multifamily in the United States. If you start from the United States, you nail it. Investors like when you show that you can develop also in a mature economy like that. But this is the only project we have out of 9 projects all over the world, in Brazil, Colombia, and India. So we are understanding the gist of that business, but in this moment, we'll keep on being focused on the build to sell. But we're ready to jump on the build to rent if the opportunities are right.
That makes sense, fair enough. And let's talk a little bit about technology as well, right? You've kind of highlighted that in Turin you have a central, development center, and like people are looking into what kind of technologies can be built and deployed all the way across all your assets, right? Why? So it's not a question of why technology is important, but I'm trying to get your perspective on why now. Because a lot of prop tech and a lot of software solutions and technology solutions for real estate have been around for a couple of decades now. Are you seeing some kind of inflection point? Is something changing in the market? Why do you feel that now would be a very good time, especially for yourself as a developer, to be investing into technology?
I'll give you an answer that every single person on this planet mean Earth, not our company, would give you, saying that after 2 years of pandemics, people got used to do a lot of stuff on their mobiles. But this answer is a little bit boring, right? Because everybody says the same things. I'll tell you what I think. I think that times are changing fast. And in the 20 years, in the 2 decades you're talking about, the biggest difference we see in the countries we operate in is digital transformation and age, meaning that our customers usually range from 25 to 35 years old. And they actually do everything with the mobiles already. Forget the pandemics. They were doing that even before that. And the presence of the internet and the ability of creating platform, matchmaking platforms, is actually in great use in these countries. So people just want to have the same user experience that they have when they hear music in the car or they order delivery food in their own home and in their own district. So managing the delivery with a smart lock connected to your phone, opening the door of your house with a smart lock, because maybe you also rent your house and you want to give it to somebody else when you're not in the city, so a smart lock makes complete sense. Or the ability to check in quasi real time your energy and water consumption, because you want to, you know, watch your bills on your phone, is something that people like. All these things together make a nice opportunity. People want this kind of innovation. Young people basically give it for granted. I mean, I don't want to say it too loud, but very soon, if you sell an apartment without a digital ecosystems around it, so with an app, we can do stuff, people won't even look at the apartment. Because you wouldn't buy a car today without a radio frequency switch. You wouldn't use your keys to get into your car, unless you're a very, very old car lover. And it will happen the same thing for our houses. Houses have been the same too long. House right. as an object, it's been the same too long. Doors, windows, right. okay. You know when the houses became really different? When utilities came on board. You know, before utilities, like electricity, water, house was a shelter. You go to the house because you protect yourself against criminals and immigrants and against weather agents, like heavy rains, like the monsoons in India. When utilities came, house became home, meaning your kids can study at night with electricity. You can cook inside your house because you have natural gas or electricity to cook. So utilities, you know, in the last century became what really changed the house as a place. But then what happened? Yeah, materials, regulation, blah, blah. We understand and we know the story. But actually, as an object, it remained the same. Instead, with digital transformation, the house is something different. I can understand what's going on in the neighborhood because I connect to the district. Planet app, which is our app for front-end users, is a place, is a digital place where you see what's going on in your neighborhood, in your consumption. You can get training on home usages and the way to save the environment and stuff. So the house itself is a different place. And PropTech is nothing else than supporting the digital transformation of the item house, that for too much of a long time has remained a little bit too similar to itself. I mean, I don't want to underestimate the relevance of the materials, technology or constructions, and the beautiful thermally insulated windows we get nowadays. My background is engineering. I know all this stuff. But if you think about the user experience of the resident in the apartment, it's remained the same for too long. And now digital transformation can definitely change this. Everybody talks about artificial intelligence in these days. I still think that we should look after natural intelligence for a little bit more, not just talk about artificial intelligence, but imagine what this platform applied to the housing environment can do when you have a general artificial intelligence system associated to it. It's mind-blowing. We're just at the very beginning. We don't see what's happening. I remember when I connected to the internet the first time when I was at university in Turin in 1995. It looked like it was magic. And now, my kid, 6 years old, when we go on holiday in a hotel, thinks that everywhere in the world you should have Netflix, Disney Plus, or Prime Video. It is not like that. You know what I mean? So we are just at the very beginning of a big change.
Very interesting. Actually, the point that you mentioned about once utilities came into the house, that completely changed the living experience, right? And that being an inflection point, that's very insightful. And that could be like another way to think of living experience and how, you know, technology can change that living experience. Exactly. Maybe talking a little bit more on that, especially around, let's say, property management. So something that we notice quite a bit is that developers, especially in the sale market, when they're building to sell market, right? So in the build to sell market, create the asset, sell it, and maybe after a year or two, completely exit the project. And maybe there is an owner association, a resident welfare association, like a committee gets, you know, like set up, and they continue managing the property thereafter. And we notice quite a bit that the maintenance and upkeep of the property kind of like starts going down. Because a lot of these owners, like who form the committee and associations, they're not really trained to kind of handle this, and they focus too much on the short-term cost savings and don't really focus a lot on long-term value creation. And even developers want to exit the project in some capacity fairly quickly because for so many reasons, you don't want to be like, you know, like held liable for all the small things that might come up post-delivery of the project. So on both sides, there is people don't want to kind of continue that relationship. But from a long-term point of view, the asset quality and maintenance like takes a hit, right? Any thoughts on whether you want to continue staying invested as a property manager as well in these assets? Like, what are the thoughts there?
Well, I think it should require days of talks with you, which I'm available for, so it depends on your time. But thank you for the question, because it's really important. So let's first of all, let me tell you that developers, when they sell you a house, their dream is not to hear from you anymore in their lives. This is what you're saying. So what you're talking about is the Residential Welfare Association, or commonly known in India as societies, are something different. Let's try to clarify what you asked me in one or two topics to be very clear for the people who are actually watching your podcast. Planet doesn't go away when the development is delivered and sold to the customers. We stay. We don't go away. We stay. Why? Because two layers of innovation we have, which is the community development for our residents, and also the ability to run our digital ecosystem prone to digital services that we sell to the residents, is something, it's important for Planet. In fact, we have three business units. One is real estate, of course. Yeah, one is digital, and the other one is advisory, which basically means we help third-party developers to do what we do. But the second one is a BU, is a business unit, the digital, because it's got its own P&L. We don't just provide digital ecosystems and digital services to our residents to do some gimmicky marketing and to push people to buy our own apartments. No. The digital business unit of Planet is meant to make money. And we are already doing that in India, because after not a very long time, like 6-9 months of pre-development, we are on the market now with what we call Planet SIM, Smart Infrastructure Management, which is basically a B2B platform where we support the societies in India, the Residential Welfare Association, to manage the water distribution within buildings. And in a very short time, really very short time, maybe in another situation, or maybe you invite me again, I can give you detailed numbers, we collected more than 55 societies, which is thousands and thousands of people. And we are aiming to go very soon up to 300 societies under management for our water smart infrastructure management system, which is a IoT/software system. We help the societies to manage water saving, because you know everything is automated, you don't have overflows, you understand what fails are. I mean, it's too long to explain, but people are going crazy because it's exactly what they want, and it's working. So this is one of the reasons we stay after we deliver the homes. And we can also provide this one to third-party developers of already built projects, because as you know, in this moment we have three projects running in India. So you might ask me, Danny, how is it possible? Three projects, 55 societies, what's the trick? Trick is that this B2B software/IoT application gets sold to existing societies. Right. And there is not only in our own development, but third-party developers and societies keep phoning us because they want this kind of solution. And this is why we stay after we deliver the homes, because we know how to. Also, let me tell you, when I speak about community development, our people do not perform the same job as the Residential Welfare Association. We don't want to substitute those kind of people, the counselor and stuff. We provide something different. Our social specialists, community specialists, don't look for broken pipes. They look for broken hearts. What does it mean? Usually I say this to explain. Conflicts at the local level, management of the amenities and shared spaces, activities for kids, for single mothers, for the elderly people. This is what we do. And this is why the communities that we embrace in our model love what we do in Planet. They feel pampered. There are social specialists, community specialists, who look after the needs of the segments of that district. Maybe the elderly people have a special need. Maybe the kids need to have activities at the local level. This is what we do. But we finance this in our own projects, because the model for community development is very specifically determined so that we need some months, not years, to understand what the community wants and give governance tools to the communities so that after a specific time, let me tell you, 6-9 months, when we step back, the community starts to self-generate solutions. How? Creating a committee for the single mothers, creating a committee for the elderly. So we basically give the community the tools and the understanding of how to self-generate solution to their everyday issues. It can be the cleanliness of the district, it can be people always parking badly somewhere, the people will look after their place. And this takes me directly to my last topic, which is, if with social innovation you actually take people to understand the long-term value of the district and their assets, something magic happens. they will go to the society and ask to do better maintenance. You know, you told me something degrades in time. It degrades because the demand is not very qualified. But if you teach people how much important it is for the long-term value of the property to look after it, to manage it, they are going to ask the society to do a better job. And then the society must activate to actually try to do a better job. And this will take us to answer the question how to do a better job and everything, but maybe another situation we can talk about.
It is an interesting approach. This is kind of more of like a tech-first approach to keeping in touch with your customers even through the long run.
So, Danny, one of the questions that I really like talking to real estate developers about is around the topic of sustainability and decarbonization. Where Planning Group is based, which is in the UK and Italy, I know that sustainability and decarbonization is definitely a hot topic of discussion. But where you're actually operating, which is, let's say, Brazil, India, and all the emerging economies, these markets are probably not yet ready to start paying a premium for sustainable buildings or buildings which have low carbon emissions. So you as a company, how do you think about handling this dichotomy?
So let me tell you, interestingly, you mentioned a premium price with the decarbonization option. Maybe we should try to change this mindset. I'll try to explain. When I speak in public, I usually say that it's possible to work on the E of ESG if you change a few assumptions on what we usually think is necessary to do to decarbonize an industry. For the real estate, for example, in our case, I don't want to speak for the others or for other segments, I don't know that well, but in our segments, we are already been studying, this is confidential, so I can give you only some information, but for 1 year and a half, 2 years, we've been studying a prefabrication system that basically could provide volumes and we could deploy it like one for every tier two cities we're interested in order to serve two or three building sites, fully productive, because with one industrial facility you can serve three building sites, and you can get very easily to reduce the time of construction by 40%, the CO2 by 20%, construction prices 5-10% at least. So this kind of situations let you achieve the first steps of a decarbonization path actually with a pricing, basically underlying cost, that are not very different from what you already doing in the market. And that's key, because if you ask people to pay a big premium to decarbonize, people are going to say no, especially like in the economies you were mentioning. But if you provide the same product, more or less at the same price, this young generation won't think about it twice, and they will choose the so-called green option. Things are changing. Young generations, our customers, are getting ready to understand the level of sustainability of the houses they're going to live in. But let me add something. When we talk about decarbonization of real estate, and again, I'm talking just about affordable housing, so residential products, people always concentrate somehow, because this is the peculiarity of the industry, on the construction process. But let's not forget that decarbonize an asset means also to look after the operational carbon, not only the embodied carbon that you have in the asset itself.